shed some light in this relationship, because Frank Lyon, on the one end, as I said, is quite a toxic drug, but it's also essential for lymphoma development. And so it's really the key cytokine in between the hemoglobin system and bone. And then we also know that every form of inflammation is associated with bone loss. So it's now clear that bone cells regulate the hemopoietic stem cell niche. Bone cells provide growth factor essential for hemopoiesis and immunopoiesis, and erectile meiosis, which affect IL-7. And bone marrow provides bone cells precursors, the same kind of stem cells, precursors of osteoblasts, monocytes, for example, are precursors of osteoblasts. These cells, on the other hand, make a number of cytokines that are key for bone. And a large producer of soluble red fiber, TNF, make a number of cytokines that are really important in regulating bone function. B cells participate to the process as well. In fact, B cells signal three T cells through their CD4 receptor. And it's only when CD4 is bound to CD4 ligand T cells that the B cells produce large amount of OPG. They are regulating the effect of red ligand on osteoclast formation. And indeed, animal models with B cells are characterized by low OPG production, high end ligand, and increased bone loss. And there are an important relationship between mesenchymal stem cells and bone. Here again, mesenchymal stem cells make osteoclasts, and both in frank ligand and regulate osteoclasts. Mesenchymal stem cells and T cells regulate each other. T cells regulate the function of mesenchymal stem cells through surface receptors such as CD40 ligand and NOTCH. T cells really educate mesenchymal stem cells to become effective osteoblasts and be responsive to a number of stimuli. Osteoblasts form in animals without T cells don't function normally because they don't receive the regulatory influence of T cells. And on the other hand, mesenchymal stem cells are very potent immunosuppressive agent. They shut down T cells through a number of mechanisms, including production of TGF-beta, anti-oxide, and IDO. Clinically, you know, we have known for a long time, and again, any form of inflammatory disease is associated with bone loss. The best example is rheumatoid arthritis. Inflammatory osteolysis is the loss of bone around a prosthetic device, like a hip prosthesis. When you get inflammation around that prosthesis, possibly due to the release of MPS, you lose bone. Periodontal bone disease is due to a local inflammation associated with bone loss. MPS induced bone loss, and when you have endotoxin ground, you have bone loss. And we are now very proud to add estrogen deficiencies and PTH-induced bone loss to the list of conditions that should be regarded as inflammatory states associated with bone loss. So I'd like to talk to you about PTH because it's a really very interesting point. Here's the dilemma. Patients that have hyperparathyroidism, a clinical condition characterized by a sustained overproduction of PTH, develop osteoporosis, they lose bone. And experimentally, if you put a pump that delivers PTH in continuous fashion in the mouse, and you create a state that we call continuous PTH administration, PTH exerts a stable catabolic effect, stimulates bone resorption, leads to bone loss. So we know, clinicians in this field know, that hyperparathyroidism is a very common cause of osteoporosis. On the other hand, if you take the very same organ and you administer intermittent, namely you give an injection at intermittent PTH, right PTH, the opposite happens. You have a very potent bone anabolic effect, very significant stimulation of bone formation and increase in bone mass. So the very same bone that is recognized as a very potent and common cause for osteoporosis is an FDA approved treatment for osteoporosis. And the difference is the time, the modality of exposure of bone cells to this hormone. But how this works, nobody knows. For 30 plus years, really, a number of great investigators have dedicated their professional life to try to understand how is it possible that one hormone, one receptor, a well-known intracellular signal pathway, leads to completely opposite effect. So the dogma is that when given continuously, PTH binds to its receptor, an osteoblast induces rank ligand production, and then leads to new osteoclast formation of hormones. And that dogma stems from early work that showed that the PTH receptor, which is called PPR, it's expressed in every cell of the osteoblast individual. So at the same time, stem cells, osteoblast, osteocytes. But about 30 years ago, it was recognized that the same receptor is also expressed in macrophages and lymphocytes. And that information was simply ignored. But strange, the receptor is there. But nobody paid any attention to that receptor and what is it doing there. So for a number of reasons, we decided to explore that. And so one day, we decided to put a pump, the leader in PTH, in continuous fashion, in wild-type mice, and in new mice. And new mice have a strength characterized by an almost complete deficiency of T cells. And as a control, we first put back T cells to a new mice, we reconstituted the mouse with a normal T cell DNA, and then we gave PTH. Then we measured bone density by DEXA, and we saw that in control mice, there was the expected rapid loss of bone, about 8% in 2 weeks in the field. But in mice lacking T cells, there was no bone loss. And again, in the other control, you first put the T cells back, and then you give PTH, you restore the normal loss of bone. And this was the beginning of the story that led us to realize that T cells have needed for PTH to work. And so the model that we developed and published was that T cells regulate osteoblast and their precursors, the stromal cells, through the CD4 ligand receptor expressed on their cells. Normally, CD4 ligand binds to CD4 expressed in dendritic cells. That's what immunologists know. But it just happened that CD4 is also expressed in stromal cells in osteoblast. And so when CD4 signal is activated, the stromal cells differentiate into competent osteoblasts. They are ready to respond to PTH. When PTH stimulates these cells, they make large amount of rank ligand and MCCF to get lots of osteoclasts and bone loss. On the other hand, if the stromal cells differentiate into an osteoblast in a mouse without T cells or without CD4 ligand expression of T cells, the stromal cell becomes a very lousy stromal cell. The response to PTH makes very low level of rank ligand, there's no osteoclast formation, and PTH does not induce bone loss. Now, in many systems, when you take a T cell and you stimulate with something, that T cells will make TNF, which is a very important osteoclastogenic cytokine. TNF synergizes with rank ligand and induces osteoclast formation. So we want to ask the question of whether PTH induces TNF production by T cells. So again, we put a pump in a mouse to measure PTH, and we measure the production of TNF by CD4 and CD4 T cells. And what we found is that indeed T cells make TNF, and PTH stimulates the production of TNF. So, you know, TNF is made by many cells. Basically, almost every cell in the body makes TNF. So we wanted to demonstrate that the specific pool of TNF made by T cells is relevant for the effect of PTH. So to do this, we did our favorite reconstitution experiment. So we took T cells from TNF knockout mouse. These T cells cannot make TNF. We transplanted these T cells in a new mouse so that we created a chimeric mouse where every cell in the body except T cells in this residual mouse can make TNF. And when we did that, you know, we treated the mice with PTH and we measured bone volume by micro CT. So again, we saw bone loss in control mice, no bone loss in mice lacking T cells. Again, bone loss in mice transplanted with control T cells, novel loss in mice with the cells lacking in the capacity to make an answer. And I think that that established pretty strongly the fact that the TNF produced by T cells play a role. So the model became a little more complicated. PTH stimulates T cells to make TNF. TNF targets stromal cells. TNF again targets also osteoclast precursors. But in this case, the most relevant effect is that TNF induces the expression of CD40 in stromal cells. So in the presence of TNF, the stromal cells express CD40 so that the CD40 ligand of T cells can activate CD40 signaling in stromal cells, making the cells responsive to PTH. Now in this diagram, I show PTH targeting directly the T cells, but how do we know that this is the case? You could argue that PTH might stimulate another cells, which in terms induces T cells to make TNF. So to address this point, we develop a conditional knockout mouse. Basically, we develop a mouse where T cells, and only T cells, lack the expression of the PTH receptor PPI. So it's funny how sometimes a lot of work can be summarized in one slide. But when we measure the effect of PTH on Babeckia bone boil by micro CT, we found that as expected, PTH causes bone loss in the wild type equivalent mice, the Klotz-Klotz mice. There was no bone loss in the heterozygous mice that had only one copy of the PTH receptor in T cells. And there was actually an increase in bone volume in mice without the PTH receptor in T cells. It was very strange to see that the deletion of PTH receptor in T cells, really an unlikely player in this system, almost converted the effect of continuous PTH in that of intermittent PTH. We went from a catabolic effect to an anabolic effect. So now we could legitimately say that PTH target T cells directly through the PPI receptor, induce TNF, TNF again, CD40, making all this chain work. So now let me talk a second about intermittent PTH, because clinicians again are more interested in the solution to the problem than the cause of the problem. So are T cells needed for PTH to work in an intermittent fashion? To address this question, we developed another very simple animal model, so we advise and give them daily injection 7 days a week for the joy of the postdocs doing the job for a month. And then we measure bone density by the exercise. So here you can see that in wild-type mice, especially if the mice are young, like in this one, they were 6 weeks old, PTH really has a very potent anabolic effect with a very, very significant increase in bone density. You know, in 4 weeks, there was really a huge increase. Now, if you take, now we're talking to the immunologists, they told us that human mice are not really a very good model because they still have some residual T cells. Really want to study animals without T cells, you need to use TCR alpha, TCR beta knockout mice. These mice lack the alpha beta T cells, which are 99.9% of the T cells. So when you give PTH to a TCR beta knockout mouse, you still get an anabolic effect, but it's about half of what you see in a wild type mouse. And if you transplant back T cells in these mice and you give PTH, then you restore a normal response. This is even more clear by micro CT, very nice increase in DVD in control mice, blunted response in mice lacking T cells, and a normal response in mice previously reconstituted with T cells. So, this is an histological section of the field. And, you know, this is a bone trabecular, and this is the bone marrow. And I think that this slide really tends to be restored. So, pathologists are very interested. Cells here. These are the lining osteoclasts. These are the osteoclasts on the surface of the bone trabecula. These are the cells that make you bone. So this is a control mouse, and you see that these cells are fairly flat. Now, when you treat a mouse with PTH, these osteoclasts become plump or cuboidal. And when bone pathologists see a cell like this, they can tell you for sure that there is new bone formation taking place. Right? This is the osteoclast that is active. So now look at the T cell deficient mouse. The lacking osteoclasts are very flat in baseline condition and remain completely compare desserts to this. And now you can see that in the absence of dessert, the mouse really lacks the capacity of being reborn quickly in response to the pH. And the reason for that, and I can't assure you that, is because in the absence of dessert, intermittent pH fails to regulate every step of the life and death of an osteoblast. PTH fails to increase the commitment of mesenchymal stem cells to the osteoblastic lineage, fails to stimulate osteoblast proliferation, differentiation, and PTH increases osteoblast apoptosis in the absence of dessert. Now, how does PTH work? How does PTH induce spore loss? The short answer is that PTH activates wind signaling in osteoblasts. So, very briefly, the key players in the wind signaling pathway is an intracellular protein called beta-catenin. In resting condition, beta-catenin is bound to a bunch of other intracellular proteins and is targeted for proteasomal degradation. Now, when a wind ligand or wind protein from here binds to the wind coreceptor complex, which includes LRP5 or 6 and the freezer receptor. So when the wind ligand binds to this receptor, now these proteins release beta-catenin because they become associated with the receptor, and they release beta-catenin, which now migrates to the nucleus and activates transcription. Beta-catenin activates the transcription of all the genes required for osteoblast proliferation and differentiation. So there are maybe 100 papers that show that PTH activates wind signaling in osteoblast, induces the translocation of beta-catenin of the nucleus, and induces all the genes that you need to make one. But until recently, there was not one single study that asked the question of which of the 20 or so wind lines that have been discovered, which one is responsible for the activation of wind signaling in osteoblasts in response to PTH, and what is the source of that wind line? So, these cells are actually known to make some wind line. So we proposed the hypothesis that perhaps these cells potentiate the effect of intermittent. Because in response to PTH, they release the right wind ligand. So we started looking for a wind ligand that had to be made by these cells and was known to activate osteoblastogenesis. And so we screened three, wind 3A, 7B, and 10B. And the good one was wind 10B. So first of all, when you treat mice in vivo with intermittent PTH, and then you harvest the bone marrow and purify these cells, and you look for the production of wind protein, we found that the only wind ligand which was upregulated was wind 10B. And that happened only in bone marrow CD8 T cells. This is the PCR and this is a Western blot. So in vivo, no spleen or circulating blood T cells respond to PTH, and in the bone marrow it's only the CD8 T cell. But if you take a T cell and you stimulate it in vitro, every T cell will make wind 10B. So there is a specificity in vivo, but not in vitro. That means that probably there are microenvironment-generated signals that regulate that T cells and make it responsive to PTH. Please keep this point in mind. So, you know, then we did a bunch of additional experiments. So this is in whole bone marrow from PTH-treated mice. You measure more wind 10B. You take bone marrow from PCR beta knockout mice, there's no stimulation of wind 10B. Now, if you take the whole bone marrow and you purify the major constituent, all the T cells respond to PTH with an upregulation of wind 10B. So, with this in the bank, it was time to prove that wind 10B plays a relevant role in vivo. So, again, we took T cells from wind 10B knockout mice, we transplanted these mice in PCR beta knockout mouse so that this recipient mouse can make wind 10B from any cells except the T cells. And again, we get PTH and we measure bone volume. So control mice, nice increase in BPD with PTH, not much of an effect in T cell deficient mice. You put back wild type T cells, you restore the anabolic response. But if you transfer these cells lacking the capacity of making winter B, there is no anabolic activity. So again, that really proves that in vivo, winter B made by these cells is required to maximize the anabolic effect of the pH. So we went back to our PPR knockout mouse, so the mouse which does not have pH receptor in T cells, to ask the question whether direct signaling of PTH in T cells is needed to make winter B. And the answer is yes, because in control mice, PTH treatment in vivo induces production of winter B, in a knockout mice, does not. And that's the micro-CT again. The controlled mouse responds to PTH as expected with an increase in DDTV, but mice lacking the PTH receptor in T cells do not show an anabolic response. Yes. Same story. We didn't get the loss of all. But you ask, is there winter B production? No. And that's actually, I'm going to get to that because that's a very interesting part of the story. So the model that we propose is that PTH targets T cells through the PPR receptor, induces winter B, and winter B activates winter B signal in the osteoclastic compartment, leading to expansion of the osteoclastic pool. Yes.
But the fact that it only happens in the bone marrow, there has to be someone else involved.
Yes. Yes.
I mean, it may or may not be a direct signaling of PTH to T cells, right?
So there is a direct signaling of PTH to T cells, but it is more to this story.
Okay.
Local microenvironment is very important. I'm going to get to that. So, winter B is really a very powerful agent, and this is some work that we did before. So, you know, again, if you treat intermittent PTH mouse, you harvest the T cells again, lots of winter B. So we decided to take a constitutively reactive winter B and transduce T cells with a retrovirus to induce massive release of winter B. Then we transplanted them T cells in a T cell deficient mouse. But without giving any PTH, we looked at what happened to the bone body. What you see is that in a mouse, the T cell deficient mouse has been reconstituted with T cells that make winter B, lots of it. You don't do anything else in this mouse. In 8 weeks, gets a very nice increase in bone density, in bone volume. So we went a step further.
Can I ask something?
Yes.
Can you recap this by just injecting with winter B?
Yes, but winter B is a very, has lots of other effects, and it's a sticky protein, and it costs an arm and a leg, so you could do that. Running out of juice, and it's there. Study. So now we transduce an hemopoietic stem cells to the retrovirus to the constitutive anti-winter B. And then we literally irradiated a wild-type mouse. We transmitted what hematologists do, the hemopoietic stem cell transplant. We put that in this mouse. So now all the new hemopoietic stem cells generated after the transplant will make pounds of winter B, not only the T cells. And that's what happened to the bone of that mouse. In the metaphysis, you get a very nice increase in trabecular bone. But what was striking to me is that if you look at the diaphysis of a control mouse, you know, you get a rim of cortical bone, there is no bone in the bone marrow. But that's what happened with the overproduction of winter B. It's really a very large formation of new bone in the diaphysis. So that was sort of a proof of concept that winter B could be used for regenerative medicine, for fracture healing, or application of that nature. And again, perhaps, you know, implanting hemopoietic stem cells in a way, but it could the other way, like making a specific and affordable winter bee protein to put in one of your scaffolds would be a way to go along. So now I'm going to change slightly subject. So in 2003, this paper was published in Nature, showing that osteoblastic cells regulated the hematopoietic stem cell tissue. So this was really a huge discovery that osteoblasts are needed in hematopoietic stem cells. And the more important was actually stem cells have a surface receptor named JAK1, which activates much signaling in hematopoietic stem cells, and then leads to an expansion of hematopoietic stem cells. And PDH was shown to upregulate JAK1 and increase the expansion of hematopoietic stem cells, perhaps suggesting that PDH could be used to improve the outcome of bone marrow transplant, because when you do a bone marrow transplantation, actually nowadays you don't transplant the entire bone marrow, you just transplant hematopoietic stem cells, you simply don't have enough hematopoietic stem cells. The more you transplant, the better, and because the recipient of the bone marrow of the stem cells, it takes several weeks for the new bone marrow to grow, and during that period you are subject to bleeding, infections, and other nasty complications. So the mortality is still high, and pharmaceutical companies are very interested in finding strategies to shorten that length of time that takes for the new bone marrow to grow in person subjected to the stem cell transplant. So perhaps the use of PDH could be the strategy. Now, subsequent papers show that actually, in order to have hematopoietic stem cells, you need to have activation of Wnt signaling both on the osteoblastic cells as well as in the hematopoietic stem cells. So we said, well, if PDH potentiates hematopoietic stem cell expansion, and if Wnt activation is needed, perhaps once again PDH through the PDH receptor induces the production of Wnt-MB. Wnt-MB is the factor that activates Wnt signaling in hematopoietic stem cells, leading to the expansion of this need. So that was the hypothesis that we proposed. So again, we gave daily PDH to mice. We measured hematopoietic stem cell expansion, and we did find that indeed PDH expands the hematopoietic stem cells. This does not happen in mice lacking T cells. We put the T cells back to restore the normal expansion. And if you give PDH to a Wnt-MB knockout mouse, you don't get the expansion of hematopoietic stem cells. So to prove the relevance in vivo, I'm skipping a lot of this story, but basically we did a number of bone marrow transplants and we measured the survival of mice after bone marrow transplant. So if you take a bone marrow from a wild-type mouse and you transplant, irradiated recipient, which is treated either with a control vehicle or PDH, you see this, that if the control recipient doesn't get PDH, there is about 20% survival. We did this in condition, we transplanted a few hematopoietic stem cells because we wanted to have a low survival at baseline. You could do better by transplanting more cells. But so if baseline is 20%, if the recipient mouse is treated with PDH, the survival goes to 80%. On the other hand, you can do the same by treating with PDH the donor mouse. So the donor mouse will have more hematopoietic stem cells to donate. So if the donor mouse is untreated, survival of the recipient is 20%, but if you treat the donor mouse with PDH, the survival of the recipient goes up to 80%. And if you do this in Wnt-MB knockout mice, this doesn't happen. Treat recipient mice with PDH, but the donor mouse lacks Wnt-MB, the survival is very low and PDH doesn't work. And if you treat the donor mouse with PDH, and the donor mouse is a Wnt-MB knockout mouse, again, you don't get any increase in survival.
So is the Wnt-MB knockout all over or only on PDH?
And this experiment was a global knockout. This should have been done with specific Wnt-MB knockout of T cells, but that was very difficult to do. So we don't have a conditional knockout for Wnt-MB for previous study, we just transferred B cells from the wounded knockout mice. There was a huge investment of money and time to do it for this purpose, so we decided not to do it. So we published last year this paper showing that, again, the reason why PTH is fencing for the stem cells is because PTH targets B cells to the PPR receptor. Uses winter reactivates wind signaling hemopoietic stem cells and stromal cells, leading to the expansion of hemopoietic stem cells. Just want to give you an example of really crosstalk between the immune system bond and the hemopoietic system.
Sorry, can I ask you one more question? Is that independent of Notch?
It is independent of Notch. So we didn't test, we didn't do that study in the Notch knockout, so I don't know. But what we know is that wind activation is upstream of Notch. So in order to upregulate JAG1 in osteoblasts, you need to have activation of wind signaling. And on the hemopoietic stem cells, you need to have activation of wind in order to have a response to Notch. So let me go back to the big question, why intermittent pH induces a different effect of bond as opposed to continuous PTH. At the end of the day, after messing around with this for 5 or 6 years, what we have learned is that continuous PTH induces B cells to make TNF, and intermittent PTH induces B cells to make winter PTH. The opposite doesn't happen. If you harvest T cells from mice treated with PTH, T cells that comes up from a mouse treated with continuous PTH will make tons of TNF. And T cells harvested from a mouse treated with intermittent PTH, which winter B doesn't make TNF. On the other hand, you take the T cells, you stimulate it with PTH in vitro, you can do it in any way you want. You will get tons of TNF and tons of winter B. So the specificity, of course, are in vivo. And that's really an intriguing question. How does this work? So, there are one of the effects of PTH, besides what PTH does in T cells, is to target osteoblasts and induce the production of a number of cytokines, which are very important for T cell biology. And we look at a number of cytokines, but we confirm actually studies by others that continuous PTH induces production of IL-6 and TGF-beta in the bone marrow. And why these two cytokines? What's special about these two factors? Well, these are the two magic ingredients that you need to make Th17. So, CD4 positive cells, naive CD4 positive cells, they differentiate in the bone marrow, in the spleen, in the blood, in a different population of effector T cells. You have heard the terms many times. You have Th1, Th2. Now you have to remember Th17 and also regulatory T cells. So a naive T cell is induced to become a Th17 when it's exposed to TGF-beta and IL-6. A CD4 becomes a Treg when it's exposed to TGF-beta alone. So Th17 is defined by the production of IL-17. So when you find a T cell that secretes cytokine IL-17, you call that T cells a Th17. And this is a nasty guy. This is the effector cytokine that causes inflammation, bone erosion, and bone loss. In rheumatoid arthritis, or damaging the joints is done by IL-17. In Crohn's disease, inflammation is driven by IL-17. And in fact, antibody against IL-17 are the new frontier in biologicals for rheumatoid arthritis, chronic psoriasis, and inflammatory conditions. So what's special about IL-17? Well, IL-17 in terms target other T cells to make all the nasty cytokines, TNF, and cytokines. It targets osteoblasts and stimulates the production of all the osteoblastogenic cytokines. There are many papers out there to say which subset of T cells supports the formation of osteoblasts. The answer is obvious. The reason really is because TH17 makes tons of red ligand and make very low level of interferon gamma, which is an inhibitor of osteoclast transformation. So, you know, again, so far I told you about the effect of CTPH, continuous PTH in T cells, but it's true that continuous PTH targets osteoclast. That's what, except me, most people would tell you that that's the only thing that PTH do, target osteoclast. And among the many things they do, they use the release of IL-6 and TGF-beta, which leads to the formation of TH17. Again, TH17 make IL-17, but they also make, on their own, lots of RENK ligand and TNF, which stimulate absorption. But IL-17, again, target dendritic cells, macrophages, stromal cells, to make more of the same nasty guys. And TH17 also signal back to other types of T cells to make more TNF. It's actually TNF in itself is an inducer of TH17 because if you treat mice with anti-TNF antibody, you get fewer TH17. So here is a vicious circle that can lead to bone loss. So we ask the obvious question, does PTH upregulate TH17? And the answer is yes. You know, the TH17 by tell you that a small increase in numbers of TH17 like this has profound biological consequences. And we did measure the expression of IL-17. This is the message, and this is the protein, and PTH, continuous PTH, not intermittent PTH, but only continuous PTH upregulates the production of IL-17 by T cells. So, is it relevant? So we gave anti IL-17 antibody for 2 weeks to mice treated with continuous PTH. And that's what happened. I measured bone loss by micro-CT, so mice receiving PTH and an irrelevant control antibody was born. And mice treated with continuous PTH plus an anti-IL-17 antibody do not. And then if we look at serum CTX, which is a marker of bone resorption, TH stimulates resorption, and that is greatly diminished if you give IL-17 antibody. On the other hand, if you measure a marker of formation, like P1P, then TH stimulates formation regardless of whether you neutralize IL-17. As I mentioned, TH17 produces IL-17, which targets osteoclasts to make other cytokines. So if you look at that, so, and IL-17 also induces regular T cells to make TNF. So, indeed, if you measure T cell production of TNF, it's upregulated by TNF, by cell PTH. But if you give anti-IL-17 antibody, PTH has no effect. And if you look at the cytokine made by stromal cells, IL-17 antibody blocks the capacity of produced PTH to upregulate IL-6, TNF, and RENK ligand. So, we really think that TH17 play a big role because they make the pro-osteoclastogenic cytokines and they have effects on other cells that make osteoclastogenic cytokines. So, again, here I put this TNF upstream because there is literature that TNF in itself induces TH17 in parallel. But also, if you get TNF induced in bone resorption, remember that the bone matrix is the largest reservoir in the body of TGF-beta. TGF-beta is made by osteoclast and is trapped in the bone matrix. And when you resorb bone, you release that TGF-beta in active form. So 95% of the TGF-beta of the body is stored in the bone matrix. So, in another respect, this is brand new, I haven't even had time to do a nice slide, but here is the frequency of TH17 cells, and what you see in the bone marrow, as I showed you before, PTH upregulates TH17, but if you give PTH to a TNF knockout mouse, this doesn't happen, you don't upregulate TH17. So suggesting that one mechanism by which you get TH17 is because TH induces T cells to make TNF, and that what they changed is to make it more THM and T.
Okay. Is the T something cells or four positive or eight positive?
Are they what?
Are they CD4 cells or CD8 cells?
No, they are CD4.
So in your initial work, you showed a lot of the effects on the CD8 cells.
So with continuous PTH, right, it is both CD4 and CD8. TNF is made by both. With intermittent PTH, winter is made only by the CD8. So that's another interesting experiment that we just try to. We need to really try to explore this relationship between TNF and UTMB. So I told you before that if we give continuous PTH, T cells do not upregulate UTMB, and this is indeed the case. But if the mouse is treated with an anti-IL-17 antibody, here you go. Continuous PTH upregulates UTMB, same as intermittent PTH, suggesting that perhaps continuous PTH uses T cells to make TNF. TNF makes the Th17. The Th17 somehow gives a signal to remaining T cells, especially CD8, blocking the production of UTMB. So this is the first clue that we have how, you know, the system can induce that specificity. So if you have an increase in Th17, that blocks the capacity of continuous PTH to increase UTMB. That's why you don't get the stimulation. So how does intermittent PTH induce UTMB? Well, in a way, the answer is simple. Because if you look at the UTMB promoter, there are two Krebs cells in UTMB, and the inhibition of these Krebs cells blocks the expression of UTMB. So Krebs is cytokine P responsive element binding process. So the UTMB promoter has two sites for a transcription factor induced by cytokine P. And binding of PTH to the PTH receptor induces enormous amounts of cyclic AMP. The PTH receptor is a cyclic AMP making machine. So when PTH binds to the PTH receptor, the expected response is the production of cyclic AMP and the induction of UTMB. So really the question is not why intermittent PTH induces UTMB, it's why continuous PTH does not. Because it's the same pH and it's the same receptor. And so perhaps it's really the crosstalk between the bone cells and the T cells. When continuous pH induces osteoblasts to make IL-6 and TGF-beta, then induces the TH17, that shuts down the production of UTMB, interfering. We have some ideas on how that happened, but it's a little too soon to happen. So continuous pH loses the capacity of making UTMB, but the standard, the default response is for PTH to make UTMB. So the anomaly is not intermittent PTH induces UTMB, the anomaly is continuous PTH not doing it. So, I mean, so why is this? Think about why PTH works through T cells. I mean, what's the cause of that? Why we have evolved linking the response of a calcitropic hormone to the immune system. So, let me speculate. I'm getting old, so let me ask philosophical questions on how things might work. So, when you have release of calcium in the microenvironment, that calcium is picked up by T cells, and release of calcium is absolutely required by T cells to undergo activation and induce an immune response. So, now go back a million years ago, think of every human in the forest going hunting. If you get sick, if you have an infection, the default response is to lay down and stay quiet. To go hunting takes a lot of calories and energy expense. So animals that are wounded, that are sick, don't go hunting because the harvest from the hunting is probably less than the calories you use to go hunting. It's a very inefficient process. So animals, when they are sick, undergo starvation. Okay? So when you starve, you don't have calcium intake from the intestine. You don't eat, no calcium. So that causes the tendency to hypocalcemia. The
body
doesn't like hypocalcemia. So that causes a continuous secretion of PTH to increase blood absorption. That's the typical response. In fact, in humans, PTH levels are higher at night when we starve. So you eat the meat, the PTH is high for, sorry, it's suppressed for a few hours. Then at night, PTH goes up and is produced in a continuous fashion. That's why we recommend women to take calcium supplement at night to suppress that PTH. So, think about continuous PTH. We think it leads to T cell activation, release of TNF and red dye, and more absorption and release of calcium. So, you know, when you have, it makes sense to think that the continuous PTH, which is the state that you during starvation, is used to release calcium, which counteract hypocalcemia, but it's also needed by T cells to use activation. Because if you have inflammation, you're sick, you're infectious, and you eat, the calcium that your immune system needs comes from the food you eat. But if you starve, it has to come from somewhere. So the idea that inflammation is associated with poor absorption is because when you have inflammation, usually you don't have large dietary supplies of calcium. And so the immune system gets the calcium it needs by eroding bone. So there is definitely an advantage with that. So if it's true, that when we are sick, we get the calcium that we need for the immune response by inducing more absorption. And we do that through PTH, so that's why PTH is linked to the immune response. It's the opposite, it's true. So when you are healthy and you eat a regular feeding, what happens? Do we put calcium back in the body? Same when you start, you consume your fat tissue, when you eat, you feel fat. It's the same true for bone. When you eat and you are not sick, do you feel bone? And if so, how do you do that? Well, you know, it's interesting to think about the fact that when you have regular feeding, each time you eat, you increase calcium intake. And that causes a postprandial, so after meal, increasing calcium level. And that transforms the secretion of PTH from continuous to intermittent. So intermittent PTH is an invention of modern pharmaceutical industry. But where does that come from? The basis, what happens in nature, is that PTH tends to be secreted in a continuous fashion unless you eat. Each time you eat, you stop the secretion of PTH for a few hours. So basically, by eating, you transform the pattern of PTH secretion from continuous to intermittent. You eat for a few hours, you don't have PTH. When your calcium starts to go up, your PTH goes up. You eat another time, you go up and down. So, eating, and humans tend to eat more than once a day, create an intermittent part in the production of PTH. So this idea that when you have intermittent PTH, maybe you give a different signal that leads to bone anabolism, because you're eating, you're healthy, you don't need to activate your T cells, you store away calcium for the future. And so the idea that PTH comes to play is that when you eat and you have intermittent PTH, now PTH induces T cells to make an intermittent that builds bone. It makes a lot of sense to me. So it's a yin yang that inflammation is associated with starvation. Starvation is associated with continuous PTH. Continuous PTH leads to the release of TNF and other factors that lead to bone loss. When you eat, you're healthy, then your pattern of PTH secretion becomes intermittent, and that leads to bone anabolism for the purposes of storing bone. So, and you need to calcium accumulation. So, again, this is normal health, intermittent feeding, intermittent calcium intake, intermittent hypercalcemia. Periodic PTH suppression, resting T cells, intermittent bone formation, and calcium storage. So that perhaps provides a evolution. I say evolution in Georgia. In the background for why things are the way they are. Let me stop with that. What Bob is referring to is that if you look at the change in bone density in humans treated with PTH, you get a huge increase in the first year of treatment, less during the second year, and things sort of plateau. We never use PTH for more than 2 years because there is an FDA restriction, because there is a concern about induction of osteosarcoma. Wind signaling is associated with osteosarcoma. If you give a huge stimulation, induction of wind, and because of wind signaling, you know, this osteoclast may proliferate too much. So we haven't done the experiment of really treating people for many years before that with PTH. Some people think that there is an exhaustion of missing kind of stem cells. And the experiment has been done stopping the PTH and doing it. It takes about a year of rest for PTH to have a new wave of effect. And then, you know, Joe Finkelstein at the MGH, they have some data that you take all this pool of mesenchymal stem cells, you shift it to the osteoblastic lineage, and eventually you run out of cell supply. But we don't know much.
So one other thing. If you take osteoblasts or DNSCs and give them intermediate PTA versus continuous PTA,
in vitro,
or even in vivo, if you, instead of taking the T cell population out, if you took the OB osteoblasts or the stromal cells, do you see IL-6 data difference between continuous versus intermediate on those cells?
Yes, there is a difference. In fact, it is the continuous PTH that induces most of the IL-6. TGF-beta is really induced by both, but IL-6 is primarily induced by continuous PTH.
So is it known why continuous versus IL-6?
No, I have sort of shifted the paradigm, but you know, the intrinsic answer, the first question of why is different response of cells is really more deep mystery.